knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We just learned all about CD4 plus T cells, such as T helper cells, regulatory T cells, and more. Now let's learn about the other class of T cells, CD8 plus T cells. Cytotoxic T lymphocytes, or CTLs, are CD8 plus T cells that recognize their targets via the interaction of rearranged T cell receptors and the class 1 major histocompatibility complex. As we learned in an earlier tutorial, MHC class 1 molecules are expressed on virtually all cells in the body. This feature allows CTLs to thoroughly scan the tissues for cells expressing foreign or cancer-associated peptides. Specifically, CTLs are specialized in efficiently detecting cancerous cells or those infected with intracellular pathogens, such as viruses. CD8 plus T lymphocytes develop in the thymus, where they are selected for their ability to recognize non-self peptides in the context of MHC class 1 molecules. After they exit the thymus, they exist in a quiescent state and are referred to as naive cells. Naive CD8 plus T cells circulate between peripheral lymphoid organs, such as the spleen and lymph nodes, via the arterial and lymphatic systems. The tissue distribution of lymphocytes is determined by targeting proteins, which can be divided into three categories: selectins, chemokine receptors, and integrins. Naive and activated CD8 plus T cells display distinct sets of these targeting proteins that direct the differential homing abilities of these cells. Naive CD8 plus T cells express high levels of the lymph node homing receptor L-selectin, or CD62L, and CCR7, a chemokine receptor that recognizes other chemokines produced in the T cell areas of secondary lymphoid organs. At this location, naive T cells interact with antigen-presenting cells. In case a naive CD8 T cell does not encounter its specific antigen, it leaves the lymph node. The CTL response to an acute infection consists of three phases. First, the initial activation and proliferation of the CTL. Second, the contraction of effector populations. And third, the long-term maintenance of memory cells. When a CD8 plus T cell encounters the correctly presented peptide MHC1 complex, its localization and homing properties are altered in response. They undergo multiple rounds of proliferation to become activated CTLs, after which they move to the non-lymphoid sites, tether to endothelial cells, and extravasate into target tissue. Importantly, a number of the effector memory CTLs are retained in these non-lymphoid tissues, where they are poised to respond rapidly should the antigen be encountered again. The CTL memory compartment is composed of three cell types: effector memory, or TEM cells, central memory, or TCM cells, and tissue resident memory, or TRM cells. These subsets differ in their surface molecule expression and in their ability to exhibit effector functions. TCMs are found in the lymph nodes, spleen, and blood. TEMs are located in the non-lymphoid tissues and spleen, while TRMs are found in non-lymphoid tissues. Notably, only direct interaction between an APC and appropriate co-stimulation leads to full CTL activity. There are two distinct mechanisms by which CTLs encounter peptide MHC class 1 complexes. If the APC expresses an antigen, for example a virus, the endogenous MHC class 1 pathway is used for presentation. In case the antigen is not expressed, the APC acquires and processes the antigen via a process termed cross-presentation. In this process, cross-presentation is initiated by the capture of foreign or exogenous antigens by phagosomes. The antigens are then processed by a different mechanism that directs the peptides to the MHC class 1 pathway and presentation on the cell surface. When a CTL encounters such an antigen, the pathway is termed cross-priming. Antigen-stimulated CTLs most notably produce interferon gamma and TNF. These potent inflammatory cytokines activate macrophages and lymphocytes at the site of infection. Interferon gamma helps establish a T helper cell 1, or TH1, response, and further stimulates differentiated CTLs. CTLs also secrete a number of chemokines, including chemokine ligand 3, or CCL3, CCL4, and CCL5 that aid in recruitment of additional lymphocytes into the immune reaction. Cytotoxic T cells kill their targets via two major pathways. First, there is perforin granzyme-mediated lysis. For this first approach, CTL produces perforin, which is a membrane-disrupting protein. Along with a family of serine proteases, or granzymes, together they form the bulk of lytic granules within the cells. Then perforin forms a pore that disrupts the target cell membrane, and once inside the target cell, granzymes initiate cell death. The mechanism of action of granzymes is direct cleavage of substrates, such as nuclear proteins and DNA, or indirect action via a protease cascade. The second pathway is death receptor-induced apoptosis. This second approach is a receptor-based system that induces apoptosis of target cells, and it utilizes members of the tumor necrosis factor receptor, or TNFR, superfamily that are expressed on the target cells. These TNFR have a death domain that is responsible for recruiting molecules that transduce the death signal, such as FADD, or FAS-associated death domain. The two most prominent apoptosis-inducing TNFR family members are FAS, or CD95, and TRAIL, or TNF-related apoptosis-inducing ligands. Furthermore, FAS is expressed on a wide variety of tissues, whereas FAS ligand, or FAS-L, expression is restricted to activated CTLs and NK cells. The FAS-FAS-L pathway is very important in controlling T-cell numbers through activation-induced cell death, or AICD, as well as in the rejection of some tumors. Cytotoxic cells also express TRAIL, which upon binding to TRAIL receptors, induces apoptosis in a wider selection of targets and are particularly effective on tumor cells. With some understanding of CD8 plus T cells, let's move forward and check out still other T cell types and learn what those do as well.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.